Wheatgrass and Champagne Podcast. I'm your host, Mandi Rose. I'm a holistic health coach with a passion to help others find balance in their life. My belief is that we can indulge in the amazing things life has to offer, like champagne, but still stay healthy using holistic approaches. Tune in each Wednesday to hear interviews with unique holistic entrepreneurs, learn practical tips on finding balance in your life, and get all the behind-the-scenes details of what I do to navigate my own health journey. Nothing is off limits in this series, so grab your shot of wheatgrass or your glass of champagne and prepare to upgrade your life and start healing. Hi guys, welcome back to part two of episode one. This episode is going to be a little bit more emotional, even more emotional than the healing journey. So I grabbed a glass of champagne to get through it. I've thought about recording this episode 100 times since August, what I was going to say, how much I was going to say, and I knew I would not be ready to record this episode until I was completely emotionally healed. There's the saying that if you can share your story without crying, you know that you've healed. I hope I don't cry in this episode. I feel much more healed than I have ever been up to this point. So I just really want to share my side of the story. I know so many people have started noticing things from social media that my life has completely changed and curious. And I really want to just make this very positive and very inspiring. I'm not here to bash anyone. That is not the purpose of this episode. I'm not even going to be speaking about the other person's opinions or feelings very much at all. They are private. This entire process of the ending of my marriage, I've stayed very quiet about it. I've stayed very hidden and personal, even though I do share a lot on social media, especially about my health journey. I just knew that it wasn't something I wanted to make public until I could explain it in a way that would hopefully bring light and positivity to someone else who might be going through the same thing. Ending of relationships, ending of marriages are very, very difficult and heartbreaking, of course. But when you pile on some other stressor in your life, that often does lead to the ending of that relationship. So for me, it was a health journey, financial issues, whatever it might be. Those things don't just disappear because you're going through the ending of a relationship or a divorce. I don't even like to say that I am divorced or getting divorced. I like to say unmarried because it's just as much of a decision as it is to get married. Unfortunately for me, it was not my decision. It was nothing that I wanted at the time. Super surprising and shocking. And I think everyone around me and the relationship felt the exact same way. So if you are someone who is close to the person I am talking about, maybe this episode isn't for you. Although I'm not going to be doing any kind of negativity or bashing, he did paint a very victim picture to people. And if that is the image you want to continue seeing him in, just go ahead and skip this episode because I'm going to be talking about my truth, my perspective, and really just sharing how I got through that and really did that by focusing on myself, going inward, self-healing, really doing self-love. I opened up an entire spiritual journey that I am so grateful and so thankful that that came about because it really caused me to be a completely different person. I feel like when I came home from Europe, the universe just wanted to strip me of everything that may have caused my health issues in the first place. So I was at the lowest with my health and had to rebuild from the ground up. But then I also had to do the same thing with my happiness, my relationships, my living situation, my friends. I mean, just everything. So I'm sitting here now with a glass of champagne, ready to spill it all. But before I even begin talking about what happened right before I came home from Europe, I want to take a moment to thank all the earth angels in my life that helped me get through this, because there is no way on any planet that I would have gotten through this if it wasn't for my amazing friends, my amazing family, people that I didn't even know before I left for Europe came into my life. And I think the universe sent them to me because it knew that I needed strong women, strong people that were loving and compassionate and gave to me when I had given them absolutely nothing. And without them and the constant phone calls and positivity and texts and crashes on their couch overnight, crying about what was going on, without you, and you know who you are if you're listening, even some of my clients, even some of the people that were my guests at my work, Just their own stories and their love and the compassion people showed me, I feel so blessed and so grateful for you. So thank you. I know there's people on social media, you girls that I haven't even met in person. Like, thank you from the bottom of my heart, because I got through it and I feel stronger than ever. I feel more truer to myself than ever. I feel healthier than ever. It means so much to me when people reach out and say, you look really happy. You're glowing. And I cry already, because that means so much to me, because there was a moment in all of this when I just did not even know what was going to happen. That fear of the unknown, like disbelief that this was all going on. So thank you so much to every single person who has been there for me through all of this. I love you so much. All right. So since this is a champagne episode, I hope you have your glass of champagne, because it is going to get a little wild and bumpy through this episode. So grab your glass, take a sip with me right now, and let's get started. So let's go back to me being in Germany. I was away from my husband for 7 weeks. We talked once a day, every day. It was getting to be the time where I was ready to come home. And honestly, I had never been more in love with my husband than when I was on my healing journey. We spent so much time together. We spent time, you know, talking and communicating and hanging out on the couch and doing activities together, more so than we had done in years. And I could not wait to come home. I felt like I missed him so much, physically, emotionally. I just wanted to get back to our life. I wanted to heal. I wanted to feel so much better. So towards the end of the trip, he had definitely started to become very irritable with me, getting angry that I wasn't feeling 100% yet, started making comments about my holistic doctors just wanting my money, that nothing was working, that it was time for me just to like suck it up and get over it, and it was ridiculous. And I just noticed this shift in his energy towards me, just very angry and irritable, and I couldn't quite figure it out. And I thought, maybe he's just exhausted, maybe he just misses me, like there's just a lot of stress in his life, and I just can't wait to come home and like to spend a weekend together. So I started looking for an Airbnb for us to stay in. And it was very stressful because I was still not feeling 100%. I wanted to make the right decision. Financially, I hadn't been working in 2 months. Like I wanted to make sure that we were making the best decision. And based on the fact that I didn't book this Airbnb in the timely manner that he saw fit, he used it as a catapult to literally shut me out emotionally. In my heart, I knew that something else was probably going on because this was so not like him. And I got a message right before I came home that said something along the lines of, I think at this time, it's just best that you find your own place to stay and I need to think about our relationship. And I thought that was so weird. Like I was coming home in 48 hours. Like why couldn't we sit down and talk about this when I got home? It was very fishy, very weird. And I tried to communicate and message him. And I said, I'll see you at the airport. You know, we can talk about it then. You know, I'll see you soon. That is not what happened. So not only am I feeling emotional, missing him, still dealing with my health that isn't 100% yet, but now I find out that my own husband is not coming to the airport to pick me up. And this was just something I could not understand. I felt such a lack of respect for me as his wife that you wouldn't even come to the airport to pick me up. I mean, that's something that you do even for a friend. I mean, I've picked up acquaintances from the airport before. So I kept wondering and wondering, why the heck is he not coming to the airport? That just seems so ridiculous. And I even said, you can pick me up and then just drop me off somewhere. Like, I just want to see you. I just want to hug you. It's been 7 weeks. And he refused, absolutely refused. So I got on that plane, cried and cried and cried. I just felt lost. I felt devastated. I felt confused. I didn't know what the heck was going on. He had sent a friend to come pick me up. It's like he almost coordinated this whole thing. He had called my father and my best friend, who is my maid of honor, before I even landed back in the United States and told them that we were separating. This was complete news to me. And when I got home, I found out that while I was on the plane, get this, while I was on the plane, my father got into a motorcycle accident and was getting surgery. And I only found this out because he called my friend who was picking me up from the airport to tell me. He couldn't even tell his own wife that her father got into a motorcycle accident. That's how much I was just shut out completely. So not only did I land and my husband was not at the airport, he was not answering my phone calls or communicating with me, and my dad was now in the hospital from a motorcycle accident, and my health was crumbling all over again from the emotional distress. When my friend picked me up from the airport, I looked like a ghost. I was just not a human. I didn't know what the hell was going on. So I immediately go to my house the next morning to try to confront him and figure out what the heck is going on. And he opens the door, looked really hungover, and I notice my car in the driveway, but it didn't look like my car. So while I was gone, he decided to take my car, which I had purchased before we even got married and paid off, and spray paint it a rose gold color. That did not look rose gold. It was like banana yellow, like not even close to rose gold, like peach. It looked like a peach bomb. And it was not finished. The bumper was still black, like half painted, half spray painted. And this was something I did not approve of at all. Didn't even know was happening. So not only is all of that going on, but now I look at my car ruined in my driveway. And this is just the beginning. So let me fast forward a little bit. So I find out over the next week or so that he wants a divorce. He had called our financial advisors, friends, family, he was telling every single person in our social circle that we were separating, we were getting a divorce, that I wasn't happy, really just putting it on me. And I felt so blindsided. I did not understand why someone who says that they love you and care about you could not talk to you first, couldn't just pick me up from the airport, sit down with me and have a conversation. I mean, I deserve that respect, I believe. And I was locked out of accounts, passwords were changed. Like, it was as if I no longer existed in his universe. He even said at one point, like, I do not consider you my wife. This is over. You need to get with the program. Literally get with the program. And I was just trying so hard to communicate with him, understand him, figuring out what was going on. And it just seemed like I was 10 steps behind. This decision had been made long before I came home. And what do we do as females? We immediately tap into our intuition. And my intuition kept telling me there's another girl. And every single person that I would speak to about this all said the same thing. We started noticing on social media that particular someone that he was close to was hearting and liking and commenting on things. You know, we're women. We have our intuition. I knew right away that the thing I did not want to do was stalk or dig or waste any of my energy on trying to get to the bottom of that. I wanted to stay very true to myself, be the bigger person, take the high road, and just focus on my health, my happiness, and my healing. And the truth would come out. And I really advise anyone who is going through something like this, trust your intuition, because that's going to tell you more of a truth than the other person. You could try to find out the truth and track their, you know, phone or put a tracker in their car, or all the things that I know I have done in my past. But in reality, all that's going to tell you is what you already know in your gut. And my gut already knew. It was just a matter of time for the truth to come out. And the truth always comes out. So instead of wasting my energy and draining myself, that was the moment I decided to start digging into my own happiness. So I worked a lot on meditations. I did a lot of journaling. I spent a lot of time at the beach by myself, and a lot of time with my close, close girlfriends. That was such a blessing. Me and my best friend, we became closer than ever. I spent a lot of time with her and talking, and such a blessing that the people in my life never got sick of me talking about it. I think talking things over and over and over again is very therapeutic. So find yourself the people that are not going to get frustrated with you reiterating and hashing it out again, because sometimes you just have to say what's happening out loud enough times to start healing and moving forward. So that's what I did. And about a month later, I had not really seen him at all. Like I said, completely shut out. He went on a trip. He would hang out with his friends, stay overnight at other people's homes. Like, I had no idea where he was or what he was doing other than partying and all of that. So I let it be. And about a month later, I got a phone call about the truth about him and another woman. And when I got that phone call, it's like it validated everything that I knew and had been piecing together. I was just waiting to hear the truth from someone. So it came as a surprise, but not a surprise. So when I confronted him, of course, I got the typical narcissist response of just this person denying it, calling me crazy, putting it on me, reminding me of a terrible person I am. I'm the one who caused this. This isn't another girl's fault. It's all my fault. I did this, I did that. And just a reminder every single conversation that we had of why this was happening, and it was all my fault. And that was even more difficult to handle because someone is just reminding you of what a crappy person you are and abandoning you at the exact same time. So I knew that wasn't the truth. I would not let any of that into my brain. I did not, you know, I think that every failing of a relationship, we must take 50% responsibility. Absolutely, every single person must take 50% responsibility. I don't care if that person was so terrible to you, if they were, you know, abusive. It is your responsibility in the sense that you dealt with it, you stayed, you didn't heal yourself, you didn't heal your inner child, you have your own wounds and abandonment issues that you were fearful to leave. And I'm sorry to say it so harshly, but that was something I needed to embrace. I was 50% responsible for the ending of this, even though the way it went down was not necessarily all my fault, but I do know that I had to get to a point where I was no longer going to be treated as the sole reason for everything wrong in the relationship. So once I found out the truth about the other girl, I knew it was time for me to move on. I could never forgive this person for not picking me up from the airport. I just knew that that was never going to happen. I didn't care if they, you know, wanted to talk things through or figure out, you know, how we could stay together. I just felt that lack of respect that day was enough for me to move forward in my life. And then finding out about another girl and, like I said, all the other things that had happened at this point, I just felt blindsided over and over again. So we had a conversation about him wanting to stay in the house and me leaving. And I also knew that I was not going to just roll over and do things his way. His impression was that we would just walk down to the courthouse, sign a piece of paper, and I'd be off on my merry way. And I knew that that was going to be devastating for me. I needed my health insurance. I needed security. I needed stability while I finished healing. I needed time to process what was going on. I could barely exercise at this point. How was I going to pack up all my stuff and find a new place to live when I had not been working for 2 months, been locked out of this account, so I had no money, no access to anything. He was the sole breadwinner for 3 years, and there I was. So luckily, we came to a mutual agreement that he would not be forcing me out or anything like that. But over time, I started noticing the complete lack of interest in me as a human. He would not ask me how I was doing with my health. He never once checked in on me to figure out where I was staying or what I was doing. We never at any point from me coming home from Europe had even had any connection. We never sat down to eat a meal together. I think most people, when they're going through an ending of a relationship or definitely the ending of a marriage, at least have moments where they sit down, have a meal, speak to each other, figure out the future, figure out what was going to happen next. And I never even got that at all. At one point, I had to email my own husband and say, we really need to talk. We need to figure out what's next. I feel like, you know, you've already moved on, but there are things that we need to discuss. Through an email, guys, through an email, like while I'm at home crying, confused, like going through this terrible emotional trauma, I have to email my husband. And he said he wanted to talk and understood why I felt that way. And he just did not want to be accused of being with another girl. And that's why he was avoiding me. Again, this is narcissistic behavior 101. If a narcissist does not want to be called out on something, they will simply ignore you. And he said he did not want to communicate with me because all I kept wanting to know was the truth about this girl. And that's why he ignored me. And eventually he agreed to meet up with me to have a conversation. Well, what do you think happened on the day that we were supposed to meet up? I got nothing. I got no text message, nothing. And he said that he was sleeping and sick and home from work, and it was like 10 p.m. or something. So I knew that was a bold-faced lie. So after that happened, it was just pure confirmation again that it was time for me to move forward. This was about 2 months after I got home from Europe, and I just started thinking every single day, what would my new life look like? What did I want? Where did I want to live? And I kept coming back to this beautiful condo that I had visited when I was sick, right down the road from my house. And it was right on the water, had the pool, had a sauna. It was so cutesy. And one of my good girlfriends lived there. And I just said to myself, I want to move in there. And something about me is if I want something, I will be determined until I get it. And so I just kept manifesting, thinking about it, looking it up on the internet. And lo and behold, one of my coworkers, who I love so dearly, shout out to you, Shan, love you, girl, she needed a roommate as well. And it just kind of fit into like the perfect alignment where I needed a place, she needed a place, she loved the place that I love, and we just had to wait for a unit to be open. So we came to look at a condo in the community, and it was a little pricey, and it wasn't like exactly what we were looking for. And then the realtor said, well, we have one other one, but it's not fixed up yet. Would you like to see it? So of course we accepted, and we go to look at this condo, and guess what the address is, you guys? 111. And if you're following me on Instagram or know anything about me personally, is I am obsessed with synchronicities and I'm obsessed with repeating numbers. They are messages from our angels. I see 1111 all the time. When all of this stuff was going on with the divorce, I kept seeing numbers like 222, 333, 444 all the time. And so we walked up to this condo and the address was 111. I knew it was time for me to move out of my house. I knew it. I was like, all right, this is a sign. I need to get out of here. And so we accepted and we signed the agreement. So this was the part in all of it that was so confusing to me. He wanted the divorce. He made it very well known. He made it very clear. There was no wavering, but yet he never filed or wanted to file. And I thought that was so weird and so confusing. And after 3 months of me just being alone in limbo, crying, I had to make the hardest decision of my life. I knew that I had to be the one to go file. And if you are someone that gets married, which I think everyone is this way, you think to yourself, this will be forever. No matter what, I will stick it out through anything. I make a commitment to this person. I will be here through thick and thin. I will be here through sickness and in health. I will be here even, and I hate to say this, but if there is infidelity, I am someone who with grace and apology from the other person could get over that through counseling, communication, understanding, and just pure forgiveness and moving forward. I am that type of person. And I never thought there would be a day when I would have to be the one to file for divorce. And it just became very clear that he did not want to do it. I don't know why to this day. I do not understand it. The only explanation I ever got was that he was busy, which made no sense because it had been 3 months, 5 months actually, since I left for Europe. And the courthouse was actually on his way to and from work every single day. So after a lot of contemplation, a lot of tears, a lot of conversations with my family, I knew that I needed to file to protect myself. This is just a little information that hopefully helps someone out there. But if you are going through the ending of a marriage, just know that actually legally filing for divorce will protect you. As soon as those papers are filed, the other party cannot change anything. He couldn't drop me from my health insurance. He couldn't change like beneficiary. He couldn't drop me from, you know, anything that he'd been paying for already. Could not be changed, altered, or canceled. And I really needed to protect myself because, like I said, I need my health insurance. I was still going through a healing journey, and he was already starting to cancel things like AAA and little things here and there without even communicating with me whatsoever. So I needed to protect myself. So I was the one who had to do that. And he didn't want to get a lawyer. There were many times he lied and said, oh, a lawyer costs this amount of money. I talked to a lawyer, but I can't afford it. And then it all came down to he never ended up speaking with a lawyer. So once I filed, I had to have that conversation and, you know, say, this is what it is. This is what's happening. I hired a lawyer And when I first got back from Europe and all of this had been thrown in my face, I was so scared that he already had a lawyer and that I was 10 steps behind and I didn't know what to do. And I, thank God, have the most amazing parents, and they stuck by me and they are so financially smart. They've been through their own divorce and they just really helped me make smart decisions when my heart wasn't able to make any decisions. And that's something I want to like remind anyone, if you are going through something like this, our heart has a really hard time making smart decisions. You just want to do what's best for love and for the other person. And there comes a point where you have to stop caring about the relationship and the other person, especially when there's a lot of lack of respect. You have to respect yourself enough to move forward and do what's best for you. And I knew that that was the truth. And if there was ever hope of us ever being together again, I needed to do what was best for me. And so that's what I did. So I was getting ready to move out of the house. I was staying with a girlfriend at the time and just really embracing the alone time I had. I would come home at night after work and I would journal and put on these awesome Abraham Hicks meditations and kind of envision like what was next in my life, embracing the future. I spoke a lot with like friends I hadn't talked to in a really long time. I started reading a lot. My spiritual journey, I started seeing a healer. I did spiritual response therapy. I was doing Reiki, yoga. I mean, I went to a medium, which was so insane. I guess this would probably be a good time for me to share that story. Before I found out about the girl, so this was about 3 weeks after I'd come home from Europe, I went to this spiritual camp in Florida called Casadega, and I wanted to speak with a medium. I'd never really done that before, but I was just curious and wanted to know what she would say. So of course, one of the main questions I asked was about my husband and what was going on with him. And I'll never forget, she looked right at me and she said, "It's over. It's over. You need to move on." And I started crying. I was like, no. Like, I just think he's confused. And she looked at me and she said, "It's over." And I was like, holy crap. And she said to me, "He has so much going on emotionally. Like, he is drowning. He is sinking. You cannot help him. You cannot help him. You need to let him go." And that just hit me like a rock. I was like, oh my God. Oh my God, like she's probably right. Like there's no way he would be like this or respond like this. Nobody sees this in his character. This is so out of character for him. There must be something deeper and more traumatizing going on that he's willing to share with anyone. So that was a little bit helpful to understanding all of this. Then I asked her the question about him and another girl and what had happened. And she said to me that he did it on purpose to break the energetic tie that we had together. And it made so much sense to me. Like, I thought maybe it was like an accident or he was drunk or something like that, but she was very clear. And this was something that I knew in my heart before, like I said, I got that phone call. I knew that he had done it on purpose so that he could just move on, like have a reason, have an excuse, like validate to himself that he didn't want to be in this situation anymore. And I left there just being like, okay, I hear the message. And then, like I said, a week later, I got the phone call about the truth. So somewhere in all of this that was happening, it just felt like the universe had my back. And I know that sounds so crazy and I sound so happy and so like positive about all of this, because now it's been 8 months and I can look back and see things with a totally different perspective than when I was actually going through it. But little things would happen. Like, I would be out and about somewhere and I would get into a conversation with someone at the store and they would tell me information that I didn't even ask for, and they knew the other person and would tell me like details. And I'm like, what? How did that happen? How did I run into this person? Or I would have these dreams and wake up with like names of people and seeing really clearly situations that had happened like while I was gone in Europe. And then I would later find out that they were true and they did actually happen. I just knew that through all of this, I did not want to become jaded to love. I did not want to close my heart off. I continued to love him from a distance. I read a book every single day given to me by a good friend that was called Prayers for Your Husband. And every single day I would say a prayer and hope that God would help heal him from whatever issues that he was personally going through. So I just tried to keep loving through it all. And I know that sounds so cliche and so cheesy, but I just felt like I had no other option. I never wanted to go to a space of hate or anger. I never wanted to become the person that would be malicious or mean or do something to make his life any more difficult. I just knew that I wanted to take the high road, no matter what that looked like. And the only way that that was going to work is if I just kept focusing on me. So I did a lot of really fun things in this time period. I would go out with my girlfriends to networking events. I started actually going out dancing again. This was something I missed so much. People started seeing on Instagram that I was like getting dressed up and wearing makeup again, which felt so refreshing because being sick for almost a year, I never wore makeup. I never did my lashes, never did my hair, let alone had somewhere to go. So I wasn't drinking still for the first like 2 months. And I guess that's a really big point that I always forget about. But when I found out all of this was happening and I was going through the first like 2 months of the divorce, I didn't drink. I continued to stay completely sober and clean to keep my mind straight. I wanted to make smart decisions. I wanted to feel all the feelings. I did not want to numb anything. And this is the best advice I think I could give anyone. If you can stay sober through a life-changing ordeal, you will get through it a lot faster. I never wanted to numb my pain. I wanted to feel it. I wanted to embrace it. I wanted to process it. I wanted to talk about it. I wanted to think about it. I wanted to really feel it, and not in a victim mentality, not in like a boohoo kind of way, but in like a, I needed to really fully understand it all. And I knew that drinking alcohol was not going to help. It was going to confuse me. It was going to make me more sad. It was going to lead to bad decisions, like maybe drunk texting or calling him. And I just wanted to stay in full control. And I'm so grateful that it happened while I was on my healing journey, because it made it that much more easier. I knew that I couldn't drink and I didn't want to drink. So my birthday was actually in all of this. It was like such a weird time to have a birthday. He never got me a present, did not really speak to me at all on my birthday weekend. So that was a very weird feeling, but I wanted to live my best life. I wanted to just move on and be happy. And so I colored my hair. I started going out with my girlfriends and going dancing. I started being open to all opportunities, and opportunities started flooding my way. I mean, from career opportunities, job opportunities, and networking with people that I never would have met, connecting with amazing healers and doctors and people in the spiritual world. I connected with some amazing health coaches, personal trainers, people that I never would have met had I just been sitting at home with my husband every single day. And these are the moments when the light bulbs would go off, where I'd be like, wow, I was living such a sheltered life. I was living such a life that was out of alignment with my own happiness. And now the universe is blessing me with all of this. And there's no reason to be sad. There's no reason to dwell, because every single day that you dwell on the past is a moment lost for the future. And I didn't know what was going to happen. You know, at the time I thought, well, maybe we might get back together again, or maybe he might change his mind, or I just didn't know. And I just knew that I wanted to build my life. And if he wanted to come back, it was going to be on my terms and my life. Like I said, after about 2 months, I got over that real quick, and I was so happy with everything that I really embraced the new. So at this point now in November, I had a new place to live that I absolutely loved. I mean, she is the best roommate anyone could wish for. I had new friends that I was hanging out with and talking to on a daily basis. I had a new career opportunity, which was super exciting for something that I was super passionate about. I was building a brand new business, Holistic Soul Sisters, which is just a huge passion of mine to help women up-level their life in any way, whether it's relationship, because Lord knows I've been through my fair share of struggles, or health struggles, which we all know I've been there. Whether it's career or anything, I just want to have a platform to help women kind of dig deep into their self-love, into their self-worth, into their spirituality, and come out as a better version of themselves. So this was a huge passion project I went into. In this time period, I actually met someone new. Did not expect it at all. Came out of nowhere. It's kind of how they say things go, right? But you know, I had my fair share of baggage. I was still living at my house. I was still dealing with a lot of emotional trauma. He had things going on in his life, but there was something about our connection and the open communication that we had that was such a blessing to me. He inspired me to be more feminine. He inspired me to be more delicate. He made me feel so worthy and so special and cared for in a way that I'd never experienced before. And we often talk now about how we maybe wish that we would have met at a different point in our lives. But I think you're supposed to meet people when you're supposed to meet them and there's a purpose and a reason for it. And he really was there for me when I was going through a lot of this hardship. And I could speak so freely and so openly about my situation. The first time that we hung out alone, I told him I was going through a divorce. I told him everything about my healing journey. And he had so much compassion and love in his heart and understanding and let me talk about it and talk, you know, about his situation. And I just felt so comfortable around this person. And we just kind of grew that connection over time in a very authentic way. I was very honest about my traumas and my triggers and what I'm fearful of and, you know, all the hard things that had happened to me. And I just knew that he was someone special when I could sit there and cry and talk about my trauma, and he would just hug me and say, "I'm so sorry you had to go through that." And I just thought, wow, this person is so special to me. So, you know, I had a new person in my life that was willing to be there for me, and I am so grateful this new person in my life has agreed to be on a podcast episode. He's not one to be in the public eye. He's very private on social media, has private profiles all across the board, does not like being on audio or video, and he's been so supportive and loving that he agreed to record a podcast episode. We did it the other night at 1 a.m. until 5 a.m. I'm having to edit down all this content into a 1-hour episode, and we share a lot about what it was like when we met, with both of us having baggage and drama in our life. We talk about our triggers, our traumas, how we communicate through them. We talk about the funny parts of our relationship and, well, situationship, I call it, because he knows that I have a huge commitment phobia, obviously based on what had happened to me. So stay tuned. I cannot wait for you guys to meet him and hear his sexy, sexy German accent and hear just how I have learned and grown from my current ending of my marriage into a new relationship. So stay tuned, hit subscribe, because that episode will be coming out in just a few weeks. I started traveling more. I had gone to Austin, Texas to visit a dear friend of mine. I'd gone home to Wisconsin to spend time with my friends and family. I went on a trip to New York City that this amazing man I met took me on and surprised me to go to the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. I got to go with my best friend. I went on a second trip home to Wisconsin for Christmas to see my friend who'd been home from Australia. And it was just like the universe was just blessing me and blessing me with all of these fun things that I'd wanted to do for so long in my life, and just confirmation that I was on the right track and moving forward. And that's not to say that there weren't moments that I was laying on my floor, crying, sobbing hysterically, confused, didn't understand why this was happening. How could someone just completely cold turkey abandon me? How could someone just act like I don't exist from one day to the next? How could someone say to me their entire relationship with me, that they were so happy and they felt so lucky and they felt so blessed, and then tell me the next day that they were never happy and that they never should have married me, and they thought about not marrying me, but they didn't want to embarrass me? you know, these were really harsh and hard things that were said to me that I still to this day hold in my heart and say, you know what? That's so crazy. How could someone lie for years about them never being happy? How could someone act like you're their whole world and then the next day just say, no, thank you. I found something better, found someone better. And it all didn't make sense to me. And I realize now looking back that none of it has to make sense. I think our brains and our hearts want to make sense of everything. But when you can look at the bigger picture, I know that the universe needed this to happen for me. And the crazy thing about it is, you know, as I was starting to embrace my own happiness and move forward and look for happiness and gratitude and positivity and meditating and praying and journaling and doing all these things, my health just started getting better and better and better. And even though I was staying up later and wearing makeup and not being super cautious about my toxic, you know, chemicals that I put on my skin and maybe drinking a little too much alcohol and kind of eating foods that I hadn't ate in a long time, like cheese and butter and steaks and going out to dinner at restaurants that I would never do before. As I was doing these things, my health was actually getting better. And it was really weird. It made no sense at all other than the spiritual component of feeling happy, feeling like I was not living in a stressful environment anymore, feeling like I could be myself, my true authentic self. And it's just so crazy to look back on. And now I work with my clients and we always talk about emotions. We talk about these hidden traumas and triggers. We talk about things that, you know, aren't really thought of to be related to health, but are a huge factor, our environment, our relationships, our own personal beliefs about what we deserve. And I just knew I had to go through all of that to learn this lesson. And now it's been, you know, 8 months. It is April. Coronavirus has hit. So it's been a little bit of a hiccup in the divorce process. So we are not legally divorced yet. And this is also something I couldn't really understand. 2 days after I'd gotten home from Europe, he had said to me, "We are getting a divorce. You need to get on board." And now here we are in April, and I'm the one who had a file. I'm the one proactive and hired a lawyer. I'm the one who moved on and moved out, and maybe he's just not on board yet. I really don't know, but patience is a virtue. I always just keep thinking everything happens for a reason, and I just choose happiness every single day. So without sharing too many other personal details and specific situations, which I really didn't want to do in this podcast. So hopefully I found a good balance between explaining to you guys the truth and what had happened and divulging too much information. I just want to like really end it with saying that when you're going through something so devastating, like the ending of a marriage or a health journey, or even the loss of a loved one through death, the most important thing that I learned in all of it was that you must always remember that yourself is your main priority. And I know that sounds so selfish, and selfish is like a word that I think has such a stigma around it, but you must remember that you have to put your health and your happiness first above all else, because without it, you will be a lesser version of yourself. And this is something that I work on every single day, being the best version of myself. How would the best version of myself talk to someone? How would the best version of myself react to this situation? How would the best version of myself look like in a movie? And remember to always act after you think. Because when you come out of something like the ending of a marriage, I think it's very common for us to become cynical, to not want to be in love, to never want to get married again, to play the victim, to think, woe is me, and why did this happen to me, and how could someone cheat on me, and how could someone leave me, and how. We must remember that everyone's journey is their own, and we cannot change it. I knew that there was no amount of convincing, begging, crying, anything that I could do that could change his mind. And even if he did change his mind, would it be real? Would it be genuine? Would he just do it out of sympathy and sadness for me, like pity me? You know, and I didn't want any of that. I wanted to come from like an attraction versus chasing mentality. So if you are going through the ending of a relationship, or you feel like, you know, your marriage is coming to an end, there is a way that you can still save yourself, maybe save the relationship, and that is attraction. Be the best version of yourself. When they go low, you go high. If they say something hurtful to you, you don't need to say something hurtful back. If they are acting a way that you don't want them to act, like they're acting shady, or they don't call you, or they don't give you the attention you want or need, let it be. Let it be, and be the best version of yourself. Find something else to do. Start reading a book that you've been meaning to read. Go call friends that you haven't talked to in a really long time. Maybe start working out if that's something you've always put on the back burner. Get yourself, I mean, what is it called? Revenge body? Get yourself in the best shape of your life. Not for them, although it is a good motive to show them what's up. I think we've all kind of had those thoughts, and that's okay. But do it for you. Do it so that you will be ready for the next person that walks into your life, and they deserve the best version of you. We all come into a relationship with baggage. We all come in with drama. It's inevitable. We're adults. We've all been through things. But you have a new opportunity with every relationship that you get into to be a new version of yourself. And this is a blessing. If you can be honest about your past and honest about what you bring into the relationship, the baggage you bring in, but you show that person that you are not your baggage. You are not your trauma. You have it. You can acknowledge it and you can talk about it, but you are not that. You are a better version of yourself. I think that is so special, and it's the best gift that you can give a new partner. And that's something I just really have focused on. And I'm so lucky and so blessed to have found someone that feels the same way. And I'm so grateful to all my friends who have stepped in and done the littlest things. I mean, I had friends that came from England and they bought me the cutest necklace that I will forever have and remember just the love and the compassion they wrote in the card and spent with me and continue to support me, even though they were friends with my ex and still are to this day. There's blessing in finding people who don't pick sides. Of course, you're going to have friends that pick sides. That's just the way it is. But for those people that can still support and love you and the other person, that's very mature. And I don't hold that against anyone. There was a lot of people in his life that immediately just cold turkey me because of what he said about me, what the things that he was spreading, telling them I'm a negative person and telling them that I did all these mean, horrible things and that I was abusive and all these things that he, I believe in his head, wanted to tell himself so that he believed it and felt better for his actions, felt justified for what he was doing to me. And he really painted that picture for the social circle he had around them. And that's okay. That's natural human behavior. And I don't fault anyone for believing his side of the story or, you know, picking his side. That's okay. I had people in my life that kind of did the same, even though I was more objective and honest about everything going on. But we all learn and we all grow, and just moving forward with the people in your life that love and support you. And I had to cut out a lot of people that fell into the negativity trap that wanted to hold me accountable for the person I used to be. You know, they would say things like, well, you're not the same Mandy, or the old Mandy wouldn't be like this, or now you're going out and partying, or now you're going out and doing this, and you've left, you know, this old domesticated housewife version of yourself behind, and I like that Mandy better. Well, I'm sorry, that's okay if you liked her better, but that's not true to me. That's not my authentic self, and that's all we can and should be in this life is our authentic selves. So let me finish my last sip of champagne. If you haven't finished yours yet, go ahead and finish it now or pour yourself a new glass. So life is just filled with unknowns. I never knew or thought that the day I got on that plane, flew to Germany, worked on myself and started healing, that that would be the last day that I was going to hug or kiss my husband. I thought we'd be together forever. I was willing and committed to doing anything I possibly could to make that happen. I wanted to do counseling. I suggested, you know, maybe a temporary separation. I was willing to give him space, and he was just not interested in any of it at all. So it is sad when someone else just gives up or feels like a temporary emotion is how they're going to feel forever. But again, there's nothing we can do. I think the natural question that people are curious about, and yes, of course, I think about too sometimes, is would I ever be able to be friends with this person in the future? You know, we had a 5-year friendship before we ever started dating. And of course, that's what made it even more devastating when he didn't come pick me up at the airport that day. It's like we had a friendship and we were coworkers and roommates, and then we dated and then we got engaged and we've been married for 3 years. Like, how does 10 years of a relationship with someone get overridden by something to the point where you wouldn't come to the airport? So I think based on that alone, maybe I now see his true colors and it would not be someone that I would be friends with in the future. But that doesn't necessarily mean that I have any like ill will or negative feelings towards someone. It's just not who I am as a person and how I treat others. And on top of that, at this point, 8 months in, we have yet to even sit down and have a drink or have a meal together or even any kind of casual conversation about our lives. And I think that speaks volumes about the relationship between us. So in short, the answer is no. I respect myself enough to know what I'm worth and to also know the type of people I want to let into my life for the future. So as I sit here on the floor in my closet, which is nothing like the closet I had at my house, I'm enjoying this glass of champagne and enjoying this downtime during the coronavirus and really just pursuing the things that make me happy. So if you're someone listening to this podcast, maybe it's shortly after it's released or it's year after it's released and you're going through the ending of a relationship or a marriage, know that I'm here for you. I'm going to say this in every single episode, so I'm sorry if I repeat myself too much, but I want people to know that if you are struggling and you are going through this and you don't know what to do, you don't know how to focus on yourself or how to get your mind off the relationship ending, or you're feeling super confused and negative, I'm here. Send me a message, send me an email, reach out in any form, and I would be so honored to just share the simple little things that I did to keep my mind focused on myself and not on him and not the ending of a marriage. Like I said, meditations I did, activities I did, you know, just sometimes it's the littlest things that we need to do to start forming new habits to create our new life. And I just hope that you guys see me as an inspiration, because the shit was hard. Like, I'm not even going to lie. No, it's been 8 months. So if I did this podcast during that time, I would be crying the entire time. Like, it was so devastating. Just looking back and seeing pictures of myself and remembering the moments that I experienced. I mean, I really worked hard for my house and everything in it and had this dream closet and spent years and years of money and time and effort on building a home with someone. And for that to be shattered, not only the relationship and the trust that you had in someone, but your home and my health and familiarity and just friendship, you know, all the friends that we had together and the things that we would do together and the future plans are just gone. I mean, it's such a stripping of your identity and a stripping of everything you've ever known. But sometimes, like I said at the beginning of this podcast, sometimes that needs to happen so that you can rebuild from the foundation up for the life that is actually meant for you. And I'm just going to end this podcast with saying, if there's any part of your life that you feel like you need to change, you have the power to do it, no matter what. Whether you are in a relationship, whether you are single, whether you are in a situationship and you're not sure what you're in, always remember that your happiness comes first, and either the person you're with will respect it or they're just not aligned on your journey, and that's okay. And like I said, I probably will never use the word divorced. Just sounds weird to me. It sounds so stigmatized, and that's not fair. I am unmarried. I have made a conscious decision to no longer be a part of a situation that is not serving me or in my best interest. So I am happily getting unmarried and moving forward with my life. And I just thank every single person who's been on that journey with me, who has loved me unconditionally, who has done the smallest things. I know I've said this already 3 times on the podcast, but I could never say it enough. And I'm moving forward and I'm so excited for the future and all the things that are to come, whether they are good or whether they are bad. If they are good, Thank you, universe. I know I deserve it. And if they are bad, I know I am strong enough to go through it. Because after I've gone through what I did in 2019, I know that I am ready to embrace anything that the rest of my life has to offer. I trust in God. I trust in the universe. I trust in my own capabilities and my own determination. And I trust that the people meant to be there for me will show up when I need them the most, and they will stick around as long as they are meant to be in my life. So thank you guys for being a part of my life and my journey. If you follow me on social media, thank you for being a part of my community, for commenting, sharing, giving me encouragement through everything. If you are not part of my social media, please go follow me. I love to connect. I'm the type of person that loves to message and communicate. I don't believe in this whole followers look at me kind of thing. I'm more of like a let's chat and get to know each other, because that is human connection and what's so important to me. So I'm going to wrap up this episode, finish my bottle of champagne. Thank you guys so much for listening. I hope that this brought some value to your life, and I'm so excited for the rest of season 2 of Wheatgrass and Champagne. You guys, I have some amazing guests coming up, so please make sure you subscribe. Tune in every Wednesday. The episodes will go live. They're on all different platforms. I even have it on YouTube for those of you who aren't too tech savvy and you just want to plug it into YouTube, search Wheatgrass and Champagne, and hopefully connect with you guys soon in person. Thank you all for listening. I love you so much. To anyone who is going through something super difficult, I send you all my light and all my love, and you are strong enough to get through anything. Trust me, we all are. It's just a matter of digging deep and finding that within yourself and healing from the inside out. So thank you guys. I hope you have an amazing day. Love you all. Cheers.